I want to do something maybe a little differently than I maybe have never done before. Usually when I get a word, I'll get a word from God, and then I'll create a message around what I heard the Lord speak to me for you. So it's a preparing of a message for you. Well, this morning I didn't prepare a message for you, but I'm going to share what I felt like God and I had an intimate conversation about. It wasn't, you know, usually if that happens, I'll take that and then I'll prepare. It's like somebody preparing a meal for somebody else, right? That's usually how I deliver a message. I prepare it for you. But I didn't prepare a message for you this morning. What I'm going to share with you, and you can kind of see it like this, you know, you go to a store and you peek in the window and see what's inside. It's you peeking in the window of me having a ministry time with the Lord. That's what you're going to get this morning. So it's kind of raw, all right? But the idea is pretty much for you to be inspired to hear what God wants you to hear. Not necessarily to walk away with what I heard, but for you to be inspired to hear what God wants you to hear. Okay? It's interesting, though, as I was reading this passage of Scripture, three things happened. One, I felt this overwhelming sense of peace. And as I felt this sense of peace, I also felt this sense of small, very, very, very small, infinite, infinitesimal small, this smallness. Out of the smallness came this sense of confidence and security, which I thought was interesting. A sense of peace, a sense of smallness, but a sense of confidence and security. That my confidence and my security came out of me being small in him. He's so big and I'm so small that actually gave me confidence and security. Isn't that interesting? So I felt like God was saying to me, when you really recognize who I am and you recognize who you are, it's okay if you feel small because I surround you with my magnitude. That gave me a sense of security and confidence. Let's look at this scripture. This is Psalm 139. And I'm going to kind of read it slowly. Verse 1 says, O Lord, you have examined my heart and know everything about me. You know when I sit up, sit down, or stand up. You know my thoughts even when I'm far away. You see me when I travel and when I rest at home. You know everything I do. You know what I'm going to say, even before I say it, Lord. You go before me, and you follow me. You place your hand of blessing on my head. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too great for me to understand. I can never escape from your spirit. I can never get away from your presence. If I go up to heaven, you are there. If I go down to the grave, you are there. If I ride the wings of the morning, if I dwell by the farthest ocean, even there, your hand will guide me, and your strength will support me. I could ask the darkness to hide me and the light around me to become night. But even in darkness, I cannot hide from you. To you, the night shines as bright as day. Darkness and light are the same to you. You made all the delicate inner parts of my body and knit me together in my mother's womb. Thank you for making me so wonderfully complex. Your workmanship is marvelous. How well I know it. You watched me as I was being formed in utter seclusion, as I was woven together in the dark of the womb. You saw me before I was born. Every day of my life was recorded in your book. Every moment was laid out before a single day had passed. How precious are your thoughts about me, O God. They cannot be numbered. I can't even count them. They outnumber the grains of sand, and when I wake up, you are still with me. So what I want to share with you are my thoughts about what I was feeling as I was ministering this to the Lord, with the Lord. Here's the first thought that came to me. How intimately and intricately God is aware of me. How intimately and intricately God is aware of me. There is no place where he doesn't know me. There is no place that I can hide from him. He is intimately and intricately so aware of me. When I originally sensed that in a less than a second, I don't know, what, maybe it's a millisecond, there was this sense of, oh my gosh. But immediately there was, oh my God. Because he knows me so intimately, so intricately. Even before I speak, even before I act, he already knows what I'm thinking. He already knows what I'm going to do before I do it, before I think it, before I even understand it. He already knows. He knows me through and through and through and through. And it's not a scary thought. It's a thought of peace and security and confidence that he knows me so well. He knows me so well. He's not standing over me with a hammer ready to pounce when I say something wrong, when I do something wrong, when I think something wrong. He doesn't have his hammer out waiting to pounce on me. His awareness of me isn't to shun me. It's to draw me. He wants to draw me because he wants me to be in relationship with him not be in rules with him. He's not concerned so much about the rules as he is the relationship. It is the rules that we abide by because of the relationship. It's my relationship with him that allows me to be able to keep the rules. The rules are because of the relationship. To keep the relationship with purity and honesty. Am I not far better off when I allow him to lead and guide me by his Spirit? This is what I'm ministering to the Lord. Am I not far better off? Far better off when I allow you, God, to lead and guide me by your Spirit. Because you know me through and through and through. You were the one who designed me, who created me. You know everything about me. Am I not far better off when I allow your Spirit to lead and guide me? Far better off. If he knows my every thought and action before I do it or think it, then can he lead me into doing what is in my best interest? If he knows me so well, surely he can lead me into doing what is in my best interest. Surely, God, because you know me so well, you can lead me into doing what's best for me. Oh, yeah. Shouldn't I trust you to know what's best for me? Shouldn't I trust you? Shouldn't I lean on your understanding of me? Shouldn't I put all of my weight on you? Because you know me so intimately? Because you designed me so perfectly? Because you created me so wonderfully? Shouldn't I put all of my trust in you? Shouldn't I put all of my eggs in your basket, God? What eggs could I put anywhere else that has the level of knowledge of me, that has my best interest at heart? Where else can I put those eggs except with you? except with you? Where else can I trust that you will bring to fruition everything that you've put in my heart? Where else can those things incubate? When I truly understand my identity in you and how great your goodness is towards me, how is it that I could entertain fear? How is it possible that I could be fearful when I know that I've been created by you? That you know me intimately. That your goodness towards me is immeasurable. That the good thoughts that you have about me are as the sand on the seashore. How is it possible that I could fear? Because your goodness not only surrounds me, but your goodness created me. Your goodness leads and guides me. How can I fear? What is there to fear when I'm surrounded by your goodness? Your goodness that's immeasurable. That's bombarding me all the time. That's overwhelming me all the time. That's looming over me all the time. That's undergirding me all the time. What are you afraid about? How can you fear? I don't know. I don't think there is anything that I should fear. Because your love and your goodness overwhelm me. When I submit my life to you, won't you surely bring me into my destiny? When I lay my life down, God, when I give my life away to you, won't you surely bring me into the destiny that you've created for my life? When I stop making my life about me, when I get delivered from making it about me and submit it to you, is there anything that can hinder you from bringing me into the destiny that you've created for me? think there is, Lord. I am my worst enemy. I am the one who can and will sabotage it. I am the one who has to be delivered from myself. I am the one who works in contradiction to your ways. But when I submit my life to you, surely you will bring me into the destiny that you've created for me. Surely. Because your goodness it surrounds me. Your mercy lifts me up and lifts me out. Your grace catapults me into far more than what I think my strengths are capable of. It's your grace that catapults me. It's your mercy that undergirds me. Surely, surely, you want to bring me into the destiny that you've created for me. For your glory, for your goodness, for your kingdom. That my life would be an inspiration. That my life would be an example about your goodness, your greatness, and your glory. Not about anything that I did, not about anything that I've said, but about everything that you've done and are doing. Surely you will bring me into the destiny that you've created for my life. Sometimes I question the perfect, good, wonderful you thought and thoughts that you have of me. Because I think, surely you can't be talking about me. Surely all the bad things that I've thought, all the bad things that I've done don't qualify me to have you think of me in that way. Lord, sometimes I struggle with your perfect, good, wonderful thoughts toward me. How overwhelming they are. How great they are. How precious they are. How numerous they are. How strong and stable they are. How happy they are. How forward they are. How great they are. How simple, they are. How complex they are. And how true they are. Even when I don't believe that they are. They are. For your goodness overshadows me. Your goodness follows me. Your goodness overtakes and overwhelms me. Surely you are good to me. Even when the wrong things happened, when the bad things emerge, when the unfortunate things are in the midst of my being, you are good to me. You are good to me. You, God, are good to me. I can't but help to be amazed by your goodness. Your goodness is never common or normal. I am always amazed. It's never normal to me because you're so good. You're so great to me. I'm so blessed to be known by you. To be loved by you. To be accepted by you. What is there to fear? What is there to fear? Usually at this time, after, depending on where I am and what I'm doing, I'll take communion. I usually do. And when I take communion, there are three aspects of the cup that I mention. One is the recognition that we live on this side of the cross, which is a big deal. I remind myself that I live on the grace side of the cross. Not on the judgment side of the cross. I remind myself of that when I take the cup. And then I thank God for all of you. And depending on what's in my heart, I'll call you by name. And then I'll acknowledge my own family. And I'll call them by name. And then the last thing that I'll do is I'll ask God that we walk in and out of what he's done for us. That we don't walk in and walk out of our stuff, but we walk in and walk out of his stuff. That our identity is in him. And typically that will close out one of my ministry sessions with the Lord in the day. You know, when I leave his presence, I feel like, you know, there are times where I feel like a sense of being wrung out. But the wringing out isn't a bad thing. He's wringing out me. Right? He's trying to get me out of me. Because what I realize is that I'm the one who prevents me in knowing more of my identity. It's our understanding of our identity that limits our walk. Where we miss our identity. Let me say it this way. When we're drawn away to do the things that we want to do, we're drawn away because of our lack of identity. Because that thing or that person or that grandiose idea, whatever it is that's drawing us away, we've allowed a place in us to lack identity. It's an issue of identity. It's a place of emptiness. And what God is wanting to do is he wants all of that to come out of me so that there are no dark places in me, that I am completely filled with his identity. And the more that I can be filled with who he is, the more completely and wholly and fully I can walk in who he says I am. And it's work, but it's worth it. The work is worth it. Let's stand.